Welcome to worship with Peace Lutheran Church out of Austin, Texas. I'm Pastor Carolyn, and I'm so glad that you are connecting with us to worship right now. Wherever you are connecting from across the country or the world, we give thanks that we can be together. If you need a bulletin for this service, you can find a PDF at peaceaustin.org. If that isn't doable for you, you also can follow along with a good bit of the music in the red ELW hymnal if you happen to have one. We'll be using music from setting 7, which begins on page 170 or 60 something. I often forget to look at this before I begin, despite having all of the warning in the world about what I need to know. Setting 7 of the liturgical music, our Kyrie, our hymn of praise, our gospel acclamation, begin on page 175. The hymns that we will sing today will be 482, I Come With Joy, and 612, Healer of Our Every Ill. Welcome if you're connecting online. Welcome also if you're connecting with us by phone. If you're joining us live on Sunday morning, September 13th, then Holy Communion follows this service of the Word and of healing on Zoom. So we will switch platforms, and there will also be a new Facebook Live video that begins after this one ends if you're connecting on Facebook Live and don't do Zoom. There is a link that will be posted in the comments on Facebook that was also sent out by email to join that Zoom meeting if you would like to continue on with us in Holy Communion. That portion of our service only happens live. If you're connecting by phone live on Sunday morning and you would like to join communion over the phone, then you can call in after this service ends. You can call, the phone number is 346-248-7799. I'll say that one more time. It's 346-248-7799. And when you hear a voice asking for your meeting ID, you hit 880-8533-9193 and then the pound sign or the number sign. Again, the meeting ID is 880-8533-9193, then the hash or pound sign. And if it asks you for a participant ID, you can just hit that hash or pound or number sign again. You don't have to have a meeting ID. It will then be connected to the Zoom meeting by the phone. So those are ways to connect if you're not here live on Sunday morning, but another time, then we will worship with Holy Communion again live on Zoom in 2 weeks. And we look forward to connecting with you there then if you wish. This week we had photo submissions that we received for a slideshow in between the service of the Word and communion on the theme of settled. And this coming week, we will have another slideshow. The theme or hashtag for this coming week is last first. So if you wish to send a photo in, you can send that by email or text or on our social pages. The hashtag for this coming week's photo theme is last first. We weekly have godly play for children. The circle is on Facebook Live at 9:30 in the morning. So if you didn't connect live, you can always still come back to the circle another time during the week. We thank our storytellers for holding that space for our children. So godly play circle at 9:30 live on Facebook or anytime you can connect later in the week. And this week we have a new Bible study for community connections beginning. That is at 1 o'clock and there is connection information in the weekly email. And if you need to know how to connect and join that group, you can always feel free to let us know. It is God's Work Our Hands Sunday in the ELCA today. And so, or this week, we observe that day of service. And there are also details about ways we are participating in service in our community, in Peace's weekly email, on our website. And you're just encouraged to find whatever call to service might come to you in this strange time, wherever you can, to be part of serving God's world. because we know that call is coming in different ways these days. With that, I invite you to take a deep breath or find any things around you that help you remember God's presence with you where you are today, whether that is lighting a candle, finding your Bible or a bowl of water, a flower, or just knowing that God is as close as your very breath. Welcome to this time of worship as we prepare our hearts and listen to the prelude. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Lord, have mercy on us, O Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us. God on high, and on earth peace
Let us pray. O Lord God, merciful judge, you are the inexhaustible fountain of forgiveness. Replace our hearts of stone with hearts that love and adore you, that we may delight in doing your will through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The first reading is from Genesis. Realizing that their father was dead, Joseph's brothers said, "What if Joseph still bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong that we did to him?" So they approached Joseph, saying, "Your father gave this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong they did in harming you. Now, therefore, please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father." Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also wept, fell down before him, and said, "We are here as your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good, in order to preserve a numerous people as he is doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones." In this way, he reassured them, speaking kindly to them. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You are invited to reflect silently as the psalm is read or join in reading it aloud. Today's psalm is Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all his benefits. Who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good as long as you live, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works vindication and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always accuse, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him, as far as the east is from the west, as far he removes our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear him. The second reading is from Romans. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. All those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God. While those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, so that we might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God, for it is written, As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then, each of us will be accountable to God. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Welcome, kids and kids at heart. We're going to talk at the children's sermon about forgiveness today. And I know that even if you're young, you probably had the opportunity at some point to say you were sorry or to ask someone for forgiveness for something you did wrong. I mean, let's think about this. Maybe a friend of yours borrowed one of your toys and broke it. And when they brought it back, they said to you, I'm sorry, and you forgave them. Well, maybe that friend borrowed a toy again the next day, and that same friend broke that toy again. And he brought it back and said, I'm sorry, and you would forgive them again. Maybe he did it for a whole week, and you had to forgive him 7 times. The lines on this paper represent each time you have to forgive him. So forgive him, forgive him, forgive him, forgive him, forgive him, forgive him, forgive him. 7 times seems like a lot, doesn't it? But that's what Peter asked Jesus about one day. He said, Lord, if someone who I know in my church sins against me, how many times should I forgive them? 7 times? And that sounded kind of reasonable to Peter. Well, what Jesus told Peter is, no, you should forgive him 77 times. Can you imagine? That would look like something like this, all these lines of forgiveness, 77. Do you know that would take us from here to Thanksgiving and then some to saying, I forgive you? Seems like a really lot of forgiving going on. Now, do you think Jesus said, well, you should only forgive him 77 times and the 78th time, he's out of luck? No, I don't think Jesus thought that either. I think what Jesus was trying to say to us is that the forgiveness goes on for forever. And that's really good news for us, because if we do something wrong, we know that Jesus and God will forgive us for it. And we should do the same for our brothers and sisters. Will you say a little prayer with me? Dear God, we're so grateful that you forgive us for our sins. And we ask you to support us and make us strong and gracious when we're forgiving others. Be with us today and every day. Amen.
According to St. Matthew, the 18th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Then Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times? Jesus said to him, not 7 times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, pay what you owe. Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me and I will pay you. But he refused. And he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And then in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. so my Heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. So this week, we get to continue in the hard work that Jesus puts before us in the 18th chapter of Matthew. Last week, we heard his guidance. We're addressing conflict in community. And he promised that he would be there with us, even when it is messy and difficult, which it pretty much always is. Now this week, he teaches about forgiveness and mercy. Equally difficult. Equally guaranteed to overflow 15 minutes of preaching and provide enough food for thought and work to last a lifetime. This week, I wanted to try a little bit of an experiment as we begin, since so many of us are connecting electronically. I'm going to ask a few questions today, and I invite you to go ahead and answer in the comments on Facebook or on YouTube if you want to, or maybe just bring a piece of paper close to jot down some thoughts to keep to yourself. Or maybe just reflect. My first question is this. I wonder what words or phrases come to your mind when you hear the word forgiveness. Feel free to comment or write down a few notes or just reflect. What words or phrases come to your mind when you hear the word forgiveness? Forgiveness. We have one more question. I also wonder where in your physical self, where in your body does that word land for you? Where do you feel the word forgiveness? And what does it feel like? I wonder. Is it warm? Like, is it like a tightening? Or an exhale? Does it have a heavy feeling for you, or is it light? I'd invite you to share some of those feelings too, if you can and if you want to. Where do you feel the word forgiveness? And what does it feel like? For me, to be honest, when I hear the word forgiveness, some of the words and phrases that spring to my mind are difficult, unworthy, maybe even just sort of a wordless deep sigh of heaviness, worry. For me, the word lands, at least today, kind of in the center of my chest. My breath gets a little shallower. I don't know if it is more because I am thinking about how I have been hurt or of how I have hurt others. But sometimes this word sort of tightens around me. Maybe for you it is completely different. Maybe it feels like freedom, like soaring, like the freshest of fresh air. Whatever you feel is what is true for you. There is no right or wrong in answering these questions. But I wanted to begin here because when we speak about forgiveness, I think very often, the first thing we do is point to like a shining example of it. And the example is usually in a relationship or in a situation that we haven't been a part of. We tend to describe and admire forgiveness when we see it enacted by others, because from the outside, I think it can look so warm and shining and wonderful and beautiful and bright, and it fits inside a story with a beginning and a middle and a happy end. But when we are inside the work of forgiveness, we know that it is more complicated and that it's hard to describe and it takes too long to untangle, and it doesn't make very often for a neat and simple story. When we speak of forgiveness, I think we know that Jesus isn't talking about the way we maybe have told children who are fighting at recess to come and stand in front of each other and say sorry to each other and don't let them go back to the swings until they do and accept each other's apologies. I, for the record, actually think we should never be doing that to children or anyone, because it is part of the reason that we can't find what real forgiveness feels like. I don't think God makes us play act apologies. And I don't think that Jesus is interested in performative forgiveness either. Forgiveness can only be real in the most important way that it needs to be real if we also have the choice to withhold it, to say what is required to repair the harm that has been done, or to wait until our anger or trauma let go of their grip on us so that we can truly choose what next step we want to take into the future. Forgiveness has to leave room for the journey of anger as well. And when we really ask to be forgiven, and we know that that forgiveness could be real, we know that that means there is also a chance of not being forgiven. Or if the relationship is in the other direction, we know that we may not be able to or be ready to offer what someone hopes for or expects. It is no wonder that part of our reaction to the word forgiveness can be fear or heaviness. Forgiveness requires truth-telling. Forgiveness involves the work of repairing harm. Forgiveness is not the absence of accountability or consequence. It is the kind of peace that follows all of that work. And I want to add that that peace can be shaped many different ways. Sometimes it can be shaped like a restored relationship. Sometimes the peace that follows forgiveness is still a separation, which may be the only way that the people involved can find to live fully and safely and well. Forgiveness is not as simple as a performative playground apology. It is not just bright and shiny. It never has been. Forgiveness is also, often, a long journey. The reading from Genesis today shows us this. You remember the story of Joseph and his fancy dress coat, yes? His brothers resented him and eventually sold him into slavery, and somehow Joseph managed to find his way into safety and honor and even power in a new land. What we hear today is from the very, very ending of that story. It's from the part that didn't even make it into the musical. Yeah. This scene where Joseph's brothers come and beg for him to forgive them, it's the second time we've heard them do that. The first time was when they first arrived in Egypt, 5 chapters ago. But now, even after they have been brought to Egypt and have lived under Joseph's care and protection, when their father dies, the brothers worry that maybe it was that relationship that Joseph really cared about. Maybe that all this time he'd been just waiting to get his revenge after his father was gone. And when the brothers come to Joseph and ask him again to forgive them, Joseph cries. Maybe it is out of sadness that they still don't believe in their relationship with him after all that he has done and said. Maybe it is out of the ache of missing his father who is gone. Maybe it is some combination of both, but he forgives them all over again and reminds them of the forgiveness he has already given. Both offering and forgiving, receiving forgiveness are hard to do, and maybe even hard to trust. The worst of our sins, the ones that still bring a knot to our stomach and set our heart racing, even years later when they just rise into our minds unbidden. It can be hard to believe we could really be forgiven, even when we have been. Guilt and shame are powerful captors. Sometimes it takes years to believe in forgiveness, or a lifetime. Sometimes it takes years or a lifetime to forgive. But as complicated as all of that is, I actually want to zoom out our focus a little bit more before we end today, because the very personal dimension of forgiveness and mercy aren't even the whole complicated picture that Jesus is painting for us today. Just like last week's teaching on conflict wasn't really just about two people, but rather the whole community. Same, I think, is true today. Forgiveness is also communal, collective, social work. And I can't think of a more important time to wrestle with that dimension of forgiveness than now. Just after the anniversary of the 9/11 attack, in the midst of a global pandemic, with fires raging in the West after a devastating hurricane in the Gulf, all while political tensions rise as a general election approaches, and while the fire of racialized violence continues to smolder as it has been for 400 years and more. It is clear now, as much as it ever has been, that we are all in this together, that our fate is bound up together on this little blue marble floating in space. And it is also as clear now as it ever has been that when we are not at peace with each other, everything that is hard becomes harder. I think Jesus is showing us about the communal dimensions of mercy today as well, just as much as the personal ones. And I think we can find pieces of that in the parable he tells. There are these two slaves or servants. One owes his master so much money that he couldn't earn it, not in 100,000 years. But the master has mercy and wipes out the debt. And then the forgiven one turns and throws a fellow slave or servant into jail for a debt equivalent to 100 days' work. Nothing by comparison. There is so much in this story, not all of it, not even most of it easy. But there's one piece that I want to think about a little bit more than we often do. The main characters are obviously important in the story. We need to work to unpack what it means that the kingdom of heaven be compared to such an earthly flawed institution as enslaving of people, and how we make sense of that as people who know that to be a great moral wrong. And we can wrestle with what the very, very difficult word about God's action means at the end, especially in the context of Matthew and Jesus' ministry, beginning in the mercifulness of the Beatitudes and ending in the great act of sacrifice on the cross. But apart from all those things, I find myself really wondering about not the main characters in this story, but the other players around the edges. After all, the master only finds out about the mercilessness of the forgiven one when the other servants go and tell him about it. The ones surrounding him seem to understand that an economy of mercy has been violated, or an opportunity squandered, or maybe it's just about fairness. But even though there were some who were interested in honoring that something merciful had been done and could have been passed on, there were others who were willing participants in the mercilessness of it all. Because after all, someone ended up doing the torturing at the end of the story. If someone is to be thrown in prison, it really takes a whole community to consent to that. It takes a whole society to imprison people. And it is cruelly ironic always to ask someone to pay back a debt from prison where they have no hope of being able to do so. By that time, the suffering, the cruelty is the point. But someone else's suffering has never yet made another person whole. The parallel to the world today is honestly almost too direct. Because while we've technically ended debtor's prison, the cash bail system we use in this country has nearly identical effects. The mercilessness of the forgiven servant is enacted on an institutional level in our community every day. And it doesn't have to be. We could be like the others around the edges, looking at the life of a sibling being sucked away without mercy or the opportunity for life. And we could go to the masters of this world and insist that mercy could rule instead, that the opportunity for life is the road that we should build. When we aren't the main characters in the story, what supporting roles can we play that enact the kind of forgiveness that Jesus shows us about? In these past 2 weeks, more than anything, I think Jesus has been calling us to build a world with as few obstacles as possible to healed relationships and fullness of life for all people. He's called us to practice walking the path of vulnerability and of reconciliation, of truth-telling. Now, living into that vision for our life together is as complicated and ambiguous as learning our own inner landscapes and the most intimate relationships where we hunger for mercy and can't yet find it in ourselves to offer it to others. It is also as concrete and vast as showing how our world is manifestly and systematically merciless and working to change it. It is complex on every level. Perhaps we can try to learn our own hearts just a little better so we can believe in forgiveness for ourselves, honor our own pain and struggles, and find in ourselves forgiveness for others that still holds accountability and repair as part of the journey, so that our relationships might be authentic, deep, and true. Perhaps we could advocate to eliminate cash bail and other merciless machines of society so that no one needs to be slowly buried in debts they can never pay, because the cycle of punishment keeps them trapped like an M.C. Escher staircase of misery. Perhaps we can be bold enough to dream that with God's help, we could help build a more merciful world that's willing to lose count of how many times forgiveness has been offered, so that we might all find out that mercy multiplies when it is on the loose among us. May you receive mercy upon mercy. May you believe that you are forgiven, and not live in the fear that held Joseph's brothers captive. May you walk the difficult road of forgiving where you have been wronged. May we all work to build a world where the chance to begin again always feels close at hand. God, the most merciful one of all, has shaped this world and offered up God's own life to show how mercy can make us alive and can continue to create life for all. Thanks be to God. Season of struggle and suffering for so many, we gather around the waters of baptism to remember who and whose we are, and to be renewed and pray for the wholeness and healing of the world. Let us pray. Blessed are you, Holy God. You are the creator of the waters of earth. You are the fire of rebirth. You poured out your spirit on your people, Israel. You breathe life into our dry bones. Your son Jesus promised to send the spirit to us that the world may know your peace and truth. Our Lord Jesus healed many as a sign of the reign of God come near and sent the disciples to continue this work of healing with prayer, the laying on of hands, and anointing. In the name of Christ, the great healer and reconciler of the world, we now entrust to God all who are in need of healing. Pour out your Holy Spirit and breathe new life into those who are gathered now. By your Spirit, adopt us all as your children, through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our whole lives, our joys and our struggles are held within our bodies, earth dust and stardust, which God declared good at the dawn of creation. God honors creation and embodied life so much that God even chose to live this life with us, with all its frailty. So I invite you today to try to see your body with God's eyes. You might close your eyes and imagine God looking at you now. Or hold your hands in front of you and think of all that they have done and held, all that they can do. Perhaps your hands bear some of the scars of moments of carelessness or of work that was too much for them. Hear this prayer for you. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, send your Holy Spirit upon your child. Drive away all sickness of body and spirit. Make whole that which is broken. Deliver them from the power of evil. Bless their hands and the work of their body. May they feel your loving embrace and tender care. Preserve them in true faith, to share in the power of Christ's resurrection and to serve you with all the saints now and evermore. Hear our prayer, healing God. Hear our prayer, healing God. Let us pray also for all God's children and all creation. Living God, grant comfort in suffering to all who are in need of healing. When they are afraid, give them courage. When afflicted, give them patience. When dejected, give them hope. And when alone, assure them of the support of your holy people. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Hear our prayer, healing God. Hear our prayer, healing God. Almighty God, who is a strong tower to all, to whom all things in heaven and on earth bow and obey, be now and evermore your sure defense. Sustain us with your Spirit, renew us in the water of life, and help us know that in the name given to us for the health and health and salvation is through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus and confess the faith of the Church, the faith in which we baptize. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Drawn together in the compassion of God, we pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. You welcome us when we are weak in faith. Uphold your church throughout the world. Make it a place of welcome. Strengthen faith through Bible studies and Sunday schools, confirmation classes, and youth ministries. Nurture new ministries of education and outreach, especially the Housing Task Force and all ministries seeking to care for people in this time of global pandemic. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. The heights of the heavens show us the vastness of your steadfast love. Have compassion on your creation. For human selfishness has brought ruin and destruction, we look to you to heal, renew, and redeem your world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Make your ways known to the nations. Speak kindness to our bitter grudges. Settle our hearts when we want to settle accounts with violence. Bless our leaders with patience and wisdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bring healing and justice wherever harm is dealt. Provide vindication for all who are oppressed. Free victims of human trafficking and forced labor. Deliver all who are bound by debt. Feed all who hunger and guard refugees fleeing famine, poverty, and war. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Teach us to forgive. Remind us that you do not always accuse us. Still our tongues when we are tempted to pass judgment and argue over opinions. Make this congregation a community of mercy for one another and for all our neighbors. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Whether we live or whether we die, we are yours. We thank you for those who have showed us faithfulness, for the knees that taught us how to bow to you, and the tongues that taught us to praise you, especially John Chrysostom, Bishop of Constantinople, whom we commemorate today. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
All these things, and whatever else you see that we need, we entrust to your mercy, through Christ our Lord. Amen. As we prepare now to listen to the music of the offertory and reflect on our offerings in this time, we remind you that you can give online if you are able to give to Peace at this time on the website, peaceaustin.org, but you are encouraged in these moments to reflect on all that you have, of which you are a steward on God's behalf, including, especially in this time, your relationships. It is not easy to do the work of tending relationships, but we are given this work for our own abundant life and for the abundant life of fellow children of God. We reflect on this work and all the other ways that we are called to care for ourselves and for our fellow children of God and for God's world.
And the last thing on your mind today, it always goes to those who don't deserve. It's the opposite of how you feel, when the pain they cause is just too real. It takes everything you have to say the word forgiveness. Forgiveness. It moves away the mad inside. It's always anger's own worst enemy. Even when the jury and the judge say you've got a right to hold a grudge, it's a whisper in your ear saying set it free. Forgiveness. Forgiveness. To love the unlovable, show me how to reach the unreachable, help me now to do the impossible, forgiveness, forgiveness, help me now to do the impossible forgiveness. It'll clear the bitterness away. It can even set a prisoner free. There is no end to what its power can do. So let it go and be amazed by what you see through eyes of grace. prisoner that it really frees is you. Forgiveness. 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 Show me how to love the unlovable. Show me how to reach the unreachable. Help me now to do the impossible. Forgiveness, one finally set it free. Show me how to see what your mercy sees. Help me now to give what you gave to me. Forgiveness. 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 Forgiveness.
Let us pray. Living God, grant comfort in suffering to all who are in need of healing. When they are afraid, give them courage. When afflicted, give them patience. When dejected, give them hope. And when alone, assure them of the support of your holy people. Help us use our gifts to serve your healing work. We ask this through our great healer, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Lord, remember us in your love and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial. And deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Now receive this blessing. Mothering God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you and lead you into the way of truth and life. Amen. As we prepare to go with a greeting of peace, I invite you to reflect as we transition towards communion for those who are joining us live on Sunday morning on the photo slideshow that was shared by members of this community on the theme Settled. Next week, our theme is Last First. You're invited to share images. If you're continuing in worship with communion on Sunday morning the 13th, you can connect through the link that's on the Facebook comments or was sent by email. If you're connecting on a digital device or by the phone number that was given at the beginning of service, I'll read that one more time just to be sure that everyone can join us. The phone number for calling in just by phone instead of through the internet is 346-248-7799. And the meeting ID is 880-8533-9193 if you're connecting by phone. We look forward to continuing on in worship with those who can join us and to worshiping again soon with everyone else.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.